Viewers, on a day when we have fresh inputs on just how bravely our forces fought to give a bloody nose to the Chinese military despite being outnumbered, Rahul Gandhi has insulted their valor. Now we know, viewers, that our fighting men are men of honor. They are extremely, extremely well known for their discipline, for viewers adhering to convention, treaties, agreements. But today, viewers, the Congress leader, Rahul Gandhi, insinuated that the army went in unarmed into combat, into a theater of action along a hot LAC, because they allowed the center to stop them from carrying arms into this theater of action for political and diplomatic considerations. Now, viewers, had Rahul Gandhi realized that our men were only adhering to treaties signed by the Congress party itself, he would never have made this suggestion. Because to suggest that the army would let the executive dictate to them on operational matters in a hot, live situation is sacrilegious, to say the least. In fact, no government would ever think the need to put diplomatic relations above the welfare of our fighting men. But by suggesting, viewers, today, the Congress former president and the Gandhi scion has not just cast an aspersion on the courage of our armed forces, our fighting men, those 20 men who, without any care for life and limb, sacrificed themselves to maintain the territorial integrity of this great nation of ours in the face of an opportunistic, barbaric, thuggish neighbor. Viewers, let me tell you, this is an insult. Now, first here, Rahul Gandhi yourself, who insinuated that our army went in there for other considerations other than stemming the advance of a thuggish rogue army like the PLA. Listen to this.
चीन ने हिंदुस्तान के शस्त्रहीन सैनिकों की हत्या करके एक बहुत बड़ा अपराध किया है। मैं पूछना चाहता हूँ, इन वीरों को बिना हथियार खतरे की ओर किसने भेजा और क्यों भेजा? कौन जिम्मेदार है?
The government was of course quick to refute the claims made by the Congress leader, Foreign Affairs Minister S. Jaishankar, reminded Mr. Gandhi of the facts. He told them all troops on border duty always carry arms. He said, viewers, and this is very critical to understand, he said that as far as our men are concerned, those at Galwan on 15 June also did so. Long-standing practice as per 1996 and 2005 agreements, not to use firearms during face-offs. Now, which governments were in office in 1996 and 2005? Maybe Rahul Gandhi was too young to remember who was in power in 1996. It was the UF government in that particular time frame, November, supported by the Congress party, viewers. It was Devegowda who took external support from the Congress. And in 2005, it was the UPA that was helmed by Dr. Manmohan Singh, and Sonia Gandhi was the UPA chairperson But at that time in 2005, she was the head of the National Advisory Council, the famed NAC that wielded all the powers, that controlled all the decision making. That was the power behind the Prime Minister's seat. So Rahul Gandhi would have known definitely, because by then he was also a member of parliament, that it was his own government that bound our braves to a pact with the Chinese. Now, viewers, shortly after this, a military veteran who was part of the negotiating committee with China under the Congress government of 1993 told Times Now that it wasn't the Modi government, but the Congress government of the past that disarmed the army at the LAC by entering into lopsided pacts to please China. Yes, viewers, let me read out to you his exact words. He said, draft came from the MEA to the army headquarters. Let's pull out that. Court graphics. I was the deputy DGMO East. I was a colleague. And a colleague went through the draft of the proposed agreement. After discussing it, we found it to be deficient. We concluded that it must include the phrase that both sides will respect the existing LAC. Yes, viewers. Nizam Bhai, let's pull out the full court graphic. That's right. That's the one. After discussing it, we found it to be deficient. We concluded that it must include the phrase that both sides will respect the existing LAC. This is what the army wanted. The word existing was critical to us. That would have forever removed ambiguities about differing perceptions with respect to the border. But I was called by J.N. Dixit, then Foreign Secretary, viewers, and he gave me a dressing down. He said, why are you being an expert on the English language? After that, the matter was out of army hands. The word existing was removed from the agreement because the Chinese didn't want it. Had we used the word, the matter would have been long settled by now. Lieutenant General Shekhatkar went on to say, I don't know why our governments don't think ahead. They seem to only focus on the short term. So not only, viewers, did the Congress Party restrain our braves from carrying weapons right up to the LAC, but they also made concessions to the Chinese along the LAC. Along the LAC, which made it possible for China to dispute where it actually was. I want you to listen to Lieutenant General Shekhatkar, who spoke to us at 6 p.m. today. And then we will speak to him live, viewers, as he exposes the secret deals that resulted in India entering lopsided agreements with the Chinese, which we still regret, and for which, viewers, our jawans have paid with their lives. Listen in.
That time also, the thrust was, let us prevent further conflict. That was the main thing. If you see the wording of the first seven clause of 1993, you will find the thrust is, do not increase the violence. Keep away from the line of control. In fact, we wanted to include one word. Instead of only line of control, we say existing line of control. Existing line of control. The Chinese objected to it. They said, no, we do not agree. And we said, no, it is a good thing, because if you had used that word, existing line of control, then there was no scope for Chinese to ingress into Indian territory. That was the basic aim. But for some reason, of course, diplomats have their own way. They are more qualified. They must be taking the things. And the discussion took place. When the army chief was, he said, look, I can't do it. I can't change it. My army chief will have to give the clearance for this. And I was taught English. And I was reminded of dictionary. And dictionary meaning. What is the difference between line of control and existing line of control?
I said there is a lot of difference. Who said this to you, Lieutenant General D.B. Shekhatkar?
If you see these agreements.
Who said this to you? teaching you English? Was it from the Ministry of External Affairs? Were they under orders from the political government at that point in time?
Madam, I'm sure there may be something, I'm very sure. But the point was, yes, we are dealing with the Ministry of External Affairs. You're right. Mr. Jain Dikshit was the foreign secretary then. Mm. Mr. Jain Dikshit was the foreign secretary, a very fine person. Mr. Shivshankar Menon was the joint secretary East that time, a very capable person. Mr. Ashok Kant, who became the ambassador to China, now he's heading a think tank in China, he was the director. And we all were in loop, we were working on that, we discussed. Chinese refused, they went back all the way to Beijing that we will not allow inclusion of the word existing. If we had agreed that time, all this interesting would not have taken place.
All this would not have taken place. That was 1993, viewers. 1996, those agreements started coming out in black and white. And this is what was said. This is what Rahul Gandhi forgets. This is what Congress governments entered into. In 1996, the confidence building measure in military field along LAC said neither side shall open fire, cause biodegradation, use hazardous chemicals, conduct blast operations or hunt with guns or explosives within 2 kilometers from the LAC. Then in 2005, viewers, by which time you might remember, the same Jain Dikshit was NSA. Shivshankar Menon was already a very senior level officer in the MEA. He went on to become NSA after Mr. Narayanan retired. At that time, in 2005, viewers, that same confidence building measure in military field along LAC that the Congress supported government entered into China was re-emphasized. Reiterating commitment to abide by the maintenance of peace and tranquility agreement signed on 7 September 1993 and confidence building measures signed on 29 November 1996. Furthermore, in case Rahul Gandhi can't think back to 2005 because he was just a first time member of parliament, maybe he's still too young. By 2013, he was tearing up ordinances, viewers. He was very much in charge. He's already the vice president of the Congress party and he was tipped to becoming the president. At that time, the Border Defense Cooperation Agreement was signed. Both sides shall exercise maximum self-restraint, refrain from any provocative actions, not use force, and prevent exchange of fire or armed conflict along the LAC. What does this tell you, viewers? That the Congress tied down our military to honor some commitment. We don't know why that was made by the Congress to China, to placate China, to keep it happy, even though the army was insistent about bending over backwards, making concessions. I want to quickly go across to Nikunj Garg and Sanjoy Chaudhary on this. Nikunj, first to you, very importantly, it's quite clear from this entire architecture of agreements and what, of course, Lieutenant General Shekhatkar has told us, that there were a large number of individuals within the Congress party ecosystem that were part of the government that were very keen on seeing things materialize in a manner that would keep the Chinese happy.
Well, yes, Rahul, it's unfortunate, and the most unfortunate part of this entire negotiating structure is that diplomats in this country probably think that overruling the military negotiating team, the members of the military negotiating team from the military side, is far more critical than overruling the Chinese or any other negotiating team from the other side that way. Now the problem is that, you know, Chinese are objecting to a word that the military people in the negotiating team want. And whom are you siding with? There was one set of diplomats at that point of time, and I am quite sure that over the years in our negotiations at various levels and with various countries, this has replicated itself, that the diplomats have wanted to side the diplomats of another with the diplomats of another country, but not the military military men of their own country. You see, this sense of superiority, this false sense of superiority over the military men is something that has doomed the defenses of this country over the since our independence. And the civilian bureaucracy's sense of superiority has been nurtured deliberately by the political class. And I say it with great amount of responsibility, because the pliance that they get from the civil bureaucracy is almost always unavailable from the military bureaucracy. And both actually further each other's cause. So the retired bureaucrats are made national security advisors and given all the plump postings because they serve the agenda of the political masters of the time. And the politicians try to reach the kind of agreements that are fed and that suit their political line of the at that particular point in time. Problem is that, you know, the domain specialists like the military men of the negotiating team are usually edged out, and it is this when agreement is coming tumbling out.
Well,
now,
that word
I can guarantee
could have made all the difference. Viewers, the keyword existing could have made all the difference, because it would have made that particular LAC inviolable. Right, Srinjoy? Those words, very critical, because you remove the word existing, now you have two differing perceptions about the LAC, and the Chinese can come breathing in and out, have a gala time, even attack our Braves with clubs.
There is no dispute with that, Rahul. The important thing to note is that General Shekhatkar has been always a very cerebral army officer. He was chief of perspective planning, and then even recently, the government decided to ask him for help. They said, we have to deal with the restructuring of the armed forces. It was absolutely imperative that it got done. And who do they turn to? They turn to General Shekhatkar. And the General Shekhatkar report is the one that is being implemented today. So General Shekhatkar is not someone to be just wished away. So if he's been told to correct his English, that would have been a very wrong thing. Because General Shekhatkar is a patriot, he's a very fine officer, and he's a very cerebral man. For him to be told that your English has to improve is not necessarily the best thing to be told to him.
Yes.
That's really one
point.
He
was rebuked.
The other point is that General Shekhatkar, yes, that was not a good thing, because he has a mind. He has always had a mind, and he is widely respected for being a very cerebral officer.
Well, Srinjoy, since all of this is documented, this army advice to that government of that day is on paper. We must access those papers. That is critical. Srinjoy Chaudhary, thank you very much. I'll come back to you in a short while on the show. I can also tell you, viewers, that the Congress, even after what General Shekhatkar has said, what in fact foreign minister of this country has said, the external affairs minister has said, sticks by its position. And it has once again continued its tirade. It has gone ahead and justified the statements made by Rahul Gandhi, which are completely out of any realm of credibility, because they completely fly in the face of the facts. Facts which are on paper. Now, we also spoke to Shiv Shankar Menon. Remember, Shiv Shankar Menon rose very high up under the UPA. And he was also made foreign secretary, superseding a large number of officers, which created a huge, huge disenchantment within the foreign affairs establishment. Yet he was there. He was very much also our ambassador to China. So he was quite the man in charge of the Chinese policy. For them all to have come out and browbeaten the army into ceding on a word which could have been absolutely critical to the future of our relationship with China requires explanation. But Shiv Shankar Menon very haughtily dismissed us when we sought a reaction from him. We'll play out this for you before I go across to General Shekhatkar and our other panelists on the show. Listen to Mr. Shiv Shankar Menon.
Good evening, sir. This is Athar Khan. I'm a consulting editor with Times Now. I was wondering if I could ask you a question, sir.
No, you can't, because I don't work Times Now or come on to Times Now.
I understand, sir. Just General Shekhatkar.
He cuts the line. He's not answerable to Times Now. Well, I don't blame him because Times Now has this habit of asking the inconvenient questions. And I want to open this out. General Shetkatkar is there with us. But before that, I want to bring in General G.D. Bakshi, who has, of course, served in these areas, knows the terrain, knows the complications that arise because the word existing was removed under God alone knows what pressure, even though the army wanted it there. You're also, sir, a military historian. And I want to come out to you, General Bakshi. I want you to put it into perspective for us. This is not just one betrayal. It's a betrayal too many. And I'm punning on the word two here. Because not only have we restrained our forces, but we've also removed a word which is today proving to be the biggest obstacle in this entire standoff with China. General Bakshi.
You know, Rahul, the word was...
Because today the entire discourse is filled with different perceptions of the NAC. And Mr. Kawal Sibal, the former Foreign Secretary, on your program, has pointed out this as to why we are giving this leeway to China. This is what General Shekhatkar was trying to point out. You see, that you give the leeway to China, that there are variable perceptions of the NAC, and therefore they are free to opt for this one, that one, and, you know, create ambiguity. There is no bloody ambiguity here. But Rahul, today on your channel, I wish to make an appeal, a fervent appeal, as a former veteran. Look, there's 1996, the 2003, these agreements were made null and void by China on the night of 15-16 June 2020, when they have used very violent means. They may not technically have been opening a fire. They have used wooden clubs with barbed wire. They have used iron rods. They have used knives to kill our braves. We have lost one colonel and 20 jawans. Right? This is not a small number. Yes, our boys gave it back as good with sticks and with stones. And there are 46 people dead on the other side because those many stretchers were counted by our boys.
Yes.
Let me put it out to you clear. 46 stretchers of the Chinese were taken out. That is a communist society that doesn't care for the individual. We respect our brave. We have given them funerals in front of the whole country. They have hidden them. And just like Pakistan refused to take back dead bodies, they are refusing to acknowledge. But Rahul, that these two agreements signed by the Congress are dead. They are null and void. And I think the government should make it plain to China. You know, what did the agreement say? Neither side shall open fire. That was 1996. And then the latest agreement then said, both sides shall exercise maximum self-restraint. What happened on the night of 15-16 June? Was that self-restraint?
No.
This is kinetic action.
Absolutely.
And it is not a small one-off, you know, mistake that happened. It is premeditated murder of our boys.
And our braves, General Bakshi, are disciplined. They are disciplined. They are a disciplined fighting force. We go by the written letter. We acknowledge and obey conventions. And we were tied down by these conventions that Kamal Sibal himself has described as a concession to China. Now, viewers, Rahul Gandhi on the back of that asking this question is really, really stretching the line of credulity. He is virtually insulting our men in uniform. And I want to bring in at this point Rajiv Desai. And I want to ask you, Mr. Desai, straight off the bat, 1996 Indo-China Agreement, 2008 Congress CPC MOU, the Congress Party signing a MOU with the Communist Party. This is not even a government to government. This is a party to party deal. Can you believe it? Saying consult each other on bilateral, regional, international developments. The Gandhis and Xi Jinping, signatories to this. And then 2017, Rahul Gandhi secretly meets Chinese ambassador to India. When the Doklam standoff was at its peak. Now, I want to ask you, sir, who is actually playing truant with our forces? That's the question.
Well, Rahul, I don't understand what all this discombobulation is about. All Mr. Gandhi did was he asked as an MP and as a leader of an opposition party, simply asked the Prime Minister, can you explain to us how Indian soldiers, why Indian soldiers A, were killed in this place, why was there a hand-to-hand fight, and what is exactly the status of what's going on in the valley? These are the questions he's asked. And where is the need to get so discombobulated? You can easily answer this question because the government will know all these issues, and they can take the people into confidence. He is an elected representative. He is a leader of a political party. They could take the opposition into confidence and explain it to them. Instead, there's all this drama of people giving statements about how Rahul Gandhi is this and Rahul Gandhi is that. I can see famous Rahul Bader sitting here. I mean, what is this? Why can't you get serious? 23
okay.
Indian
soldiers. You're in India.
For the first time in so many years, there's Don't been a death on the, along the line of okay. control. There okay. are questions okay. about where the Chinese have camped. There are questions about where the Indian troops are. All these issues, I understand that there are issues of national security and military confidence. They cannot be discussed in
this
public.
This narrative flies in the face of facts. Now, it's not as if, and give me 30 seconds, Mr. Desai. He didn't ask some innocuous question. This is exactly what he said. He made a charge. He said, friends, China has committed a grave crime by murdering our unarmed soldiers. I want to question, why were these soldiers sent unarmed? Who is responsible for this? This is obviously a straight attack on the Prime Minister. Who else?
Either it's the Army Chief or it's the Prime Minister
who heads the executive. So you tell me, who was he referring to?
Rahul, Mr. Modi has, I've got the clip. Mr. Modi himself has asked the question of the previous government when he was not even anywhere. He was the chief
Did
minister.
He ask the question, he why were our men unarmed? He didn't.
Onto a television show.
Okay, allow me. Mr. Desai, look, I'm not stopping Mr. Gandhi from questioning the government. But the choice of question matters.
These are serious matters.
One second. Let me bring in Nalin Kohli. Nalin Kohli. You've heard the individual, Mr. Desai, who is speaking.
Why don't you discuss
very,
the facts?
Okay, give me 30 seconds. Let's get the other side in.
How did the Chinese...
Let me get the other side in.
How did the Chinese get into the valley?
He's not asking that question. No one has a problem. Ask those questions. The government today held a press conference and answered those questions. That's not the question. Let me first break this down for you, viewers, since I'm being pushed now. Let me tell you. First of all, what were we told? We were told that some of our men rolled down into the water. And because they were ill-equipped, we'll listen to this, they froze to death. Now think about the topography of this area. Allow me, sir, please give me 30 seconds. Please, you had your say, you've spoken a lot. Let me just finish this point. Now, if you know the topography of this area, you will know that the only river body, the water body, is on the Chinese side. The Indians never crossed the LAC, unless, of course, Rahul Gandhi is suggesting that we did. Or the Congress Party is suggesting that we did. If they did, then they're buying the Chinese argument lock, stock and barrel, because that's what the Chinese said, that we crossed over the LAC, we broke the treaty. Now, we can't have it both ways, viewers, because had we wouldn't have got our the mortal remains of our soldiers back. The Chinese would have hung on to them. But we got them back. Then a second news was floated. Oh, that several Indian soldiers are missing. Newspapers who have a particular orientation said that. They didn't believe your army. Just like Rahul Gandhi doesn't believe the army, just like the Congress doesn't believe. This is not the first time Balakot was disputed. Before that, Uri was disputed. Any and every action by the army is disputed.
No,
it's true. Come on.
It is not the army.
We were told that crows were killed.
It is the police.
Okay, anyhow. Sir, I don't want to, I don't want to get into a war of words with you, sir. I want to bring in Nalin Kohli. He's from the Bharatiya Janata Party, sir. Why are you so disenchanted with the Congress today? Tell us.
Thank you, Mr. Shivshankar.
Mr. Desai wants
to know.
Let
me begin by saying...
And let me also tell you, Mr. Kohli, that general, that the general, the good general, Mr. Shekhatkar is still with us. I'm going to go to him right now, and you can hear it, viewers, all of you, from his own mouth, how the Congress sold us down the drain. But yes, Mr. Kohli, go ahead.
I think General Shekhatkar today has brought forward an extremely important point of view, which really keeps the continuity of the Congress policy from Nehru right up to 1996 to 2003 and even beyond, which is one of not looking at India's interests. I think it was Prime Minister Nehru, who in Parliament said not a blade of grass grows in Aksai's chin.
You should be ashamed.
And as another member of Parliament had said, not a flock of hair grows on some places, so do you give it away? I mean, this continues
what
General Rahul, he's an elderly gentleman, Mr. Desai.
So Rahul, can you stop this global time?
Mr. Desai, please, he didn't interrupt you. He didn't call you names. He didn't call you names. You'll get your chance to rebut him. But let's keep it decent. Don't behave like the Chinese here. Don't cross the line of decency. There is a line of decency here also. There's a line of debate here also, sir. Don't cross that. Please, don't behave like the Chinese. Please. No thuggery allowed. You can respond to him.
I'm very angry.
You can respond to him. That doesn't mean, sir, that you can... that doesn't mean that you can...
Why have you called this Xi Jinping?
No, one second. That doesn't mean that you can break every rule. I'm sorry. You can respond to him. No one stops you. I gave you a whole opportunity to rubbish this government, rubbish the armed forces, because that's what you sort of represent here.
Who
is this Xi Jinping
spokesperson who you
called?
Talk about facts. The facts are...
So may I, Mr.
But who is this Global Times editor who you've called?
Okay, one second.
I follow the standard rule.
One second, Shahzad Poonawalla, please.
I have my word, but
please don't let them get away with this tonight. Shahzad Poonawalla, don't let them get away with this tonight. We're going to come piece by piece and demolish the Congress argument today.
So
give me some minutes.
Teach this Rajiv Desai.
Okay, please, please, let's not get personal. Okay, let's lower everyone's faders. I'm just going to go across to Mr. Nalin Kohli. Mr. Kohli, make your statement very quickly. MR Venkatesh, Colonel RSN, both are waiting, and so is General Shekhatkar. Yes.
So therefore, first thing to say is, why did Mr. Rahul Gandhi never inform the Ministry of External Affairs or the country that he wished to meet with the Chinese ambassador while Doklam was happening? What are these questions that he's asking, and what is the tone in which he asks? How is it that Mr. Rahul Gandhi's statements are welcomed by foreign countries who are enemies of the state? Like Pakistan, the Prime Minister using his statements on Balakot, undermining the effort of our Air Force, of our army.
So you're saying there's a consistent pattern to this. Okay, let me just bring in. There's a consistent pattern, says the Bharatiya Janata Party spokesperson, to the manner in which the Congress disregards the sacrifices of our martyrs. That's what Nalin Kohli is suggesting. I want to bring in the very Honorable Lieutenant General Shekhatkar. Now, General Saab, you talked about the negotiations, and Colonel RSN is listening in very closely, because I'm going to come straight out to Colonel RSN right after this. Now, General Saab, explain to me what actually transpired in those very critical negotiations where China was given such a huge, monumental advantage. Tell us.
When the draft came from Chinese side, we got from the Ministry of External Affairs, it came to Army Headquarters, it came to the Director General Military Operation, and I was dealing with, as a Director, Deputy Director General East, that is up to China also. I was going through the whole draft, and with the help of my director, one colonel that time, now he retired as a Lieutenant General, he became the Director General of Military Intelligence. We sat down, we discussed that we must include the word existing. where the paragraphs start, both sides will respect the line of control. I say, let us put both sides will respect the existing line of control till we come to a final boundary dispute. So that all this, what is happening today, since then, will come to a stop. And that word was not accepted. Oh my God, I felt that way. I was called by Mr. Deekshith also, a very fine person. They're all very senior people. Why are you trying to be funny? Why? What is this English you are you trying to tell us? You don't think? I said, sir, this draft has come to you having been approved by chief of the Indian Army. Now it is only he can change. I have no authority. I am no one. If he had any objection, he could have cut himself that time.
Gosh.
In the afternoon, the meeting took place where the chief was also there. I don't know what transpired. I was standing outside, other things. But the fact I still maintain.
Right.
I still maintain. Had we used this word existing line of control, the difference in perception, the Chinese perception up to Chushul, tomorrow Chinese perception can be up to Ladakh.
Yeah.
They can be up to Leh. Are we going to accept the nonsense from them? Have we ever given to the Chinese what is India's perception? Have we given in writing or in person or in the maps?
No, we haven't. We haven't.
So why are we giving the benefit of doubt to Chinese when they ingress into our territory?
Yes.
It is a perception. What happens to India's perception? We belong to this nation.
That's the point.
Where are we losing our
people? That's the point. What happens to India's perception? Yes, Shehzad, since you're lifting your hand, yes, very quickly. I want to bring in Colonel Arison right after. Yes, Shehzad Poonawalla, yes.
Very quickly. Rahul, imagine that there were some Anglophiles in the Indian bureaucracy granted permission by the Indian political leadership of the time to side not with the Indian Army's position, but with the enemy or at least the adversary's position, that is the Chinese position. And there's another person who will testify to this, retired Fali Major, Air Chief Marshal Fali Major. He said, I gave them proof, go attack after 26/11. They overruled the army. This is a trend, Rahul Shiv Shankar. Today the entire country is saying, you know what, CMKMB, China ka maal karo bahishkar. And you know what Rahul Gandhi is saying? Rahul Gandhi is saying ki China ka MOU ki karunga main baat. And that's why you have Rajiv Desai who is doing CMKMB, China ki memorandum. This is under the MOU that was signed between Rahul and Xi Jinping, that they are not siding with the Indian forces but with the Chinese narrative, that they raise questions on the Indian army all the time, that they doubt the capability of the Indian army. And this is not the first time they've done it. They have consistently surgical strike, Balakot airstrike, Indian soldiers did not kill terrorists, they killed the civilians. This kind of behavior has been shown by these Congress people all the time. Hence, they should be called the Chinese Congress Party, the CCP.
Well, strong words.
Am I ranting?
No. Vivek Srivastava, 1 minute. I'm not going to allow you in. Ghanshyam Tiwari, Colonel RSN, and M.R. Venkatesh come into this debate right now. And listen, Mr. Vivek Srivastava, if you really have so many big things to say, why don't you ask your Politburo to first take a position? They have stopped sending spokespersons to debates because they're so scared someone might ask them to condemn the Chinese action, which they can't. This is a fact. This is on paper. We know this. Okay?
What?
1 minute. 1 second. I want to go straight across.
You're calling?
1 minute.
You're calling
1 second.
You army generals over here.
Listen, 1 second. You please keep silent. I haven't addressed you. 1 second. Colonel Arison, there is a consistent pattern. 1 second. Lower his fader. Colonel Arison, there's a consistent pattern. M.R. Venkatesh Poonawalla says there is a consistent pattern. I want to bring in Colonel Arison. Why is there a consistent pattern? Why is there a consistent pattern, Colonel Arison? Let's talk brass tacks tonight.
No, as we know what Honorable General Sakatkar has brought out, you know, I would have still given benefit of doubt had it, you know, said that, you know, that entire document said that, yes, in the eastern sector, it is the watershed line, which is a very logical thing. And in the Ladakh sector, it is whatever they wanted to do away with this existing I could have still, you know, given them some benefit of doubt. But the problem here is that we have been so slavish and subservient to this English language. And let me tell you, Rahul, 90% of our energy, if not 90%, 70% of the energy of the diplomatic community goes, you know, in handling the English language, in handling the, while, you know, this, the Chinese or the Japanese and others or the Russians are not, you know, encumbered by these things. So English, I have always maintained this, that English is a language to inflict inferiority complex on people. And this is what I have been involved in drafting certain documents with regard to Bangladesh, and I also face the same thing. I know this, you know, exchange of drafts used to go on whole night, and yet, you know, I mean, it used to be decided that we'll put it in the next meeting. So where was this hurry? Why was he overruled? There should be a commission of inquiry. Inquiry should be set important. Up to investigate why this, because a 4G goes for accuracy.
Yes.
A soldier does not want ambiguity.
Yes.
A soldier does not want words like perception. And he's absolutely right. That what about our perception? And if he has a perception, why should we go always by his agenda?
Why is the Chinese perception, why was it put above India's perception? Why was it put? That's the question. M.R. Venkatesh, I think Colonel RSN has put it beautifully. Why? Why? That's the question. Let's get to the brass tack. Let's get to the real question here. Tell me.
Rahul, I would put it this way. The Congress party, ever since there has been an intrusion by Sonia Gandhi, had its soul and heart outside of India. Let us be very clear about
yes.
it. It may look politically incorrect, but that's the truth of the matter. That nowhere in the world I would even believe, barring of course the communists who don't believe in the idea of nation state, would a nationalist party go about and trying to have a pact with another party and also which is perceived to be an enemy of your country. Remember George Fernandez. George Fernandez pointed out that China was the single largest enemy of India. And all these people, including Sonia Gandhi, went after him like a pack of hounds. Because they were trained to do this. This was not merely political. This was not for a love of fighting corruption. This was done very...
I think it is more important that we analyze the failure of the government rather than singling out
sir,
the opposition,
sir, do that,
which has no role
sir,
to play.
I will ask that question. 1 minute. I will do that also, sir. Please bear me. Don't interview like a Chinese. I know your loyalty to the Chinese is so high
Una.
That you don't have to demonstrate every second.
No,
please
no,
wait.
I'm not noisy,
now,
sir.
As far
you
as
don't
as
question
as
Narendra
as
Modi. You don't
sir,
have
Mr. Vivek, first condemn China. Why don't you condemn China? Why is Vivek Srivastav not condemning China?
Okay, 1 second. Let me just come in here. Everyone, please. Let's lower everyone's fader. Let me just come in. I need to restore order. The point that M.R. Venkatesh is making and the point that Colonel RSN made, very moot points. M.R. Venkatesh, I want to come back to you. Please, let's not speak over each other. Yes. Yes, go ahead.
Sir, in a democracy, each one cannot go about questioning the Prime Minister. It is the duty of the opposition and they are entitled to question the Prime Minister. But we have a stand-up comedian with a villainous stench, minus GST, to question. That is the unfortunate thing we are pointing out. That
there you
mechanism
go.
To question, the mechanism to question the Prime Minister is non-existent. So who are these people? Can you trust Rahul Gandhi to question the Prime Minister? Never. So that is the problem. Today we are in a vacuous state where
well,
we cannot question.
Rahul Gandhi is a person who overruled even Dr. Manmohan Singh. He believes he's an extra constitution authority. Mr. Ghanshyam Tiwari, I'm sorry I'm coming out to you so late, but the other speakers took up a lot of time. It's been difficult to control this debate, but I want to ask you, sir, today we have a situation where the sins that have been visited upon because of poor drafting. I don't know. I'm not trying to attribute motives. have held back, disarmed virtually our braves, pushed us into a confrontation which was thoroughly avoidable. Ghanshyam Tiwari and the Congress party has the cheek to ask the government, why did our braves, why were these soldiers sent unarmed? Can you believe it? Ghanshyam Tiwari?
Rahul, I'll say three quick things because it can be interrupted any time, as is the order of the debate today. But first, Prime Minister Modi has met the Chinese Premier more number of times than any Prime Minister of India. He and Xi Jinping have met for 18 times. The first visit of Xi Jinping, he wanted to visit Prime Minister Modi's village. That was the level of intimacy that Prime Minister Modi himself boasted among the same, in front of the same officers. The agreements that you talk about, especially in 2012 and 13, were made when the current external affairs was ministers was ambassador to China. And as you and Srinjoy spoke about, that how these foreign policy in charge have a strong saying in how these agreements are drafted.
Right.
I think you are pointing fingers on Mr. Jaishankar. Please do that. This is not the right time for media to point fingers on Mr. Jaishankar. The real question should have been asked to the government, to the defense minister, but you would not ask that. I don't know the purpose of your debate. This is an important matter. The government has failed the nation. Let every
by
Indian
sending
know this.
In unarmed and by sending in aman no no by sending in unarmed troops, that's what you're saying. Okay,
now,
so one second,
do you
you're saying that Mr. Modi had meetings with Xi Jinping
and create an agenda out of it? Or do you really want to pin the
Ghanshyam, the man who gave away 38,000 square kilometers, the party which gave away 5,800 square kilometers in 63, the party which gave away 640 square kilometers in 2013, that allowed 600 incursions, you allied with that party, and today you are asking questions of the party that has given a befitting reply to the Chinese. Here is the question. The party which gave away Aksai Chin, last entries of POK, last entries of Ladakh, last territories were incursed into during 2010 to 2013. You had no questions for them. And today you have questions for a party which has given eye-to-eyeball confrontation in Doklam and Pangong Sho and has not allowed them to do whatever they want in Galwan.
Okay.
That's the question.
Okay, one second. I want to ask, fine. The Prime Minister met with Xi Jinping not because they wanted to play Ludo together. He was the head of our state. He's the head of our executive. Give me 30 seconds, sir. Please, give me 30 seconds. And Xi Jinping is the head of, I don't know what. I mean, the Chinese Communist Party is actually a group of thugs. So he's the head of a confederacy of thugs. But it's okay. He represents China. We have to honor those international protocols. So he did meet, but there was an official purpose. We still have diplomatic ties. Now I want to ask viewers, you a question. 2008, Congress CPC, Congress Chinese Communist Party, Memorandum of Understanding, and the Gandhis go there. In 2008, what official status did any of the Gandhis have? Rahul Gandhi, what did he have? Can someone answer that question?
And the kids went to the Beijing Olympics as guests of the Chinese government. But that's a visit on holiday, unlike the role played by Prime Minister Modi when he's going there to do work for the state. And second is, let me remind Ghanshyam Tiwari, in 1996, if my memory serves me right, Mulayam Singh Yadav ji was the defense minister.
He was indeed. Your memory is absolutely right. He was the defense minister. But you see, these things are forgotten. General G.D. Bakshi, General G.D. Bakshi, I want you to come in here. The opposition is saying that, look, you are being dilatory. You're pulling out the past. We are only showing Rahul Gandhi why it is unwise of him to be asking why the government did not supposedly arm our boys to go and fight. Now, the foreign affairs minister has come out and said, but they were armed. Unfortunately, they've been disarmed by two or three treaties that have been signed by the Congress. So we went in and did a fact check, and it holds up. The words of the treaties are on your screen. So General Bakshi, what is this all about?
Rahul, as a military veteran, I would make a fervent appeal that those who do not learn from history are condemned to repeat it. At this very critical juncture in the life of our polity, when we are almost getting into a serious conflict situation, may I request humbly that we look ahead. We look ahead, and the rules of engagement, the errors of the past, need to be done away with today. We need to change the rules of engagement, and we must ensure that 2, 3, 4 days down the line, our boys are not going to face the same kind of set of restrictions that were placed in 1996, in 2003, and again reiterated. The Chinese have finished this peace and tranquility agreement. They have torn it to shreds. Let's not encumber the armed forces with this false, absolute, colossal blunder that we had made then.
What was the compulsion for the Congress Party to sign an agreement with an unelected entity like the Chinese Communist Party? That's the question, viewers, we should be asking. And remember, just a few days back, at the height of the COVID crisis, yes, Mr. Desai, can you explain this? What is the Congress Party?
I want to tell you something. This whole business that has happened in the Galwan Valley stems from the rather intemperate comment made by the Home Minister of how they're going to take POK. That is their side.
So we should not take POK? Mr. Desai, we should not take POK? We should not take POK? Do you know how many people have died in trying to take it back? How can we today completely override the sacrifices of our brave? General Bakshi, can you explain to the gentleman that they don't want to take back POK? They want to give it away to Pakistan, that state? That state that is a basket case?
Why are the Chinese troops in
Rahul?
Why did they?
We have a lobby, you know, of capitulationists.
I don't want to hear this guy, please.
Capitulationists! Give away POK! Disown Gilgit Baltistan!
MR.
Disown Aksai Chin!
MR.
It never was a part of you. It will annoy the Chinese.
That is the kind of sensitivity
we have to count out to.
Well, Viewers, this is the mentality we're up against. Give away POK, cut a deal at an intra-party level with one of the most closed organizations on this planet that runs gulags, that floods its country, that builds, constructs without any regard for its own people, that let them die because of COVID and covers up the numbers and then comes out and says, there were about 10, 20,000 people that we left out of our survey. That doesn't tell the world, viewers, that COVID is overrunning its own so that the rest of the world is in lockdown. So it can go and take over the possessions of various countries. It's doing it in South China Sea. It's doing it in Hong Kong. It's doing it, viewers, even now as we speak with the great Taiwanese. It is doing it with the Indonesians. It has done it with the Philippines. It has done it with Vietnam. It's completely taken over Pakistan. And they're very happy selling their souls. But big breaking news coming in. I'm being told, viewers, that the talks that have concluded, the India-China military talks, the Major General level talks, they're moving forward. India tells the Chinese troops to move back. Srinjoy Chaudhary has some more details on this. Srinjoy, elaborate on the details. Go back to the early May position is the message. India has decided that come what may, they want the status quo back to where it was.
Yes, Rahul, today was a meeting that was slightly better than yesterday's, and these are the following details. Number one, India made it very clear to the Chinese, look, you can't just walk in anymore. If you walk in, we will impose a cost. These are the two most important points that were made. As far as the discussions on disengagement were concerned, India also made that very clear. The end game has to be the last week of April, the positions last week of April. So far, finger has not been talked about, Galwan has been talked about, and disengagement in Galwan has been talked about. There was also some talk on the larger disengagement. As you are aware, there are about 10,000 soldiers, 100 tanks, armored personnel carriers, two regiments of artillery, AWACS and aircraft across in the rear echelons. India has also had to build up correspondingly. Now there was also talk of the Chinese thinning that down also. India made that point very clearly. They said, you came for an exercise. That was your excuse. Your exercise is over. You chose to stay back.
Go back.
Why are you doing that? Why don't you go back? If you go back, we will also go back.
Well, thanks, Srinjoy, for waiting. What is the best part of an hour to give your update to us? Thank you very much. Viewers, we go into the news hour with Navika Kumar, where more questions will be asked. More revelations will be made. Don't go away.